Mr. Rubinstein, isn't it rather paradoxical that every Wunderkind makes his orchestral debut playing one of the Mozart concerti as though they were child's play? That's hardly the case, though, is it?
Well, Mozart, the case of Mozart is a very strange one. You said, you put right away, you know, the thing in the nutshell, you know, because it is true that one plays Mozart mainly in the beginning of one's career, as a Wunderkind, or I mean as a young boy, any case, even if one doesn't use the public for it. And then at the end of one's artistic life, one comes back with all the heart to Mozart. This is absolutely true. But I can explain that very well. You see, Mozart is so utterly pure, so utterly devoid of any exterior element to help his inspiration. Because even Beethoven, who was certainly a very deep mind, wonderful genius, great musician and so on, needed a lot of help. He needed a lot of I wouldn't say artificial things, but what all those long pauses, you know, those fermatas, as he called it, you know, I mean, Mozart never used any of it. It was always flowing, it was always simple and so on. So you see what happens, a young, innocent mind of a born musician, of course, plays Mozart straight away, you know, straight. I am not quite sure if I didn't play an andante of Mozart's A major concerto more, I don't know, close to the spirit of Mozart when I was 8 or 10 years old than when I'm now. Because now I can't help myself to try to become simple, you understand?
Yes. Yes.
And that, of course, at once is a little fabricated. I try to be simple. This is a very bad thing to say. You know, I ought to be simple. You see, I was simple, certainly. When I was 10, I couldn't conceive any other way of performing that thing. Well, now, hundreds of different ways of performing. I try them even out. I try to change tempi and things like that. You see?
Yes.
It's a very, very great difference. But then I'll tell you another thing. Oh, well, there's a lovely answer which Schnabel had for Mozart. Don't you know it?
No, I don't think I've ever heard it.
Somebody asked Schnabel, well, maestro, why don't you play more Mozart sonatas in concerts? He said, you see, Mozart sonatas are so easy for children, but so difficult for artists.
There it is in a nutshell again. I don't imagine you remember, or do you, the very first time you played any Mozart in public. Let me ask you this. Do you remember the first Mozart concerto you played in public?
But of course.
You
it
do.
It was the A major concerto, number Köchel, you know, 488, which I played. Joachim, you see, the great Joachim, was going to perform it with me. That was, of course, a fantastic honor for me, you know, in public. And my personal professor, you see, Professor Bart, my music professor, my piano professor, you see, wanted to have me try it out. So actually the very first performance didn't take place with Joachim, but in Potsdam, near Berlin, with a little orchestra conducted by my harmony teacher, Mr. Kuhlenkampf, the father of the violinist Kuhlenkampf, who was not very well known in this country, but was a prominent German violinist. So that was actually the very first time I played that concerto.
Do you remember the attitude with which you approached it?
Not only I remember, but you see, my future readers, I'm writing just now my memoirs, will read a very, very important description of the whole event. This and the further concerts, you know, is Joachim and so on and so forth.
Yes, you don't want to scoop yourself now.
But this Mozart concerto became a sort of repertoire piece for about 2 or 3 years. I played it very much. But then I became an unbearably young fellow, you know, filled with Tchaikovsky, with all that sort of stuff, you know. And so the managers, of course, wanted me to bang it out. It was the Tchaikovsky concerto, Saint-Saëns concerto, and all sort of flashy pieces. So they wouldn't have any Mozart. It wasn't my fault so much. I wanted to play Mozart. They said, oh, you know, the public would prefer to, why don't you play the Saint-Saëns? You know, they were always a little bit after that. I can tell you a lovely anecdote from Portland of the 1920s.
Portland Maine,
Oregon,
or Oregon?
Oregon.
Yes.
I had there quite a good success as a soloist. And so the orchestra wanted me again for the next season. And we discussed the program, and we decided to play the fourth Beethoven concerto, certainly a beautiful piece of music, G major concerto. Everything went fine. 2 weeks before the concert, I received a telegram from Portland. The committee of the Symphony Association would be so grateful if you changed the Beethoven into a concerto of Rubinstein, Anton Rubinstein. Well, I smelled at once what's all about. You see, of course, Rubinstein plays Rubinstein, yeah. And so on. Some people might come thinking it was my concerto and what not, and so on, and that thing. Well, I was so furious that I answered, "Can't you call me Beethoven for that occasion?"
I think that situation prevails even today. That is, managers tend sometimes to underestimate the potential tastes of the various audiences. I'm sure you find that even today.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, I must tell you about Italy, the most musical country after all, the birthplace of music, of the art of music. We all know that, you know. Well, Italy, about 20 years ago, wouldn't have any Mozart. You know, all the cities, whenever I offered to play something of Mozart, were at once making faces.
Yes.
No, Mozart, not so much, you know, the public doesn't like it so much.
Well, fortunately, you know, that seems to have changed.
Yes. Beethoven had a much better stand, you know, because he was a sort of an imposing fellow, you know. He was a Prometheus, he was a threatening fellow, you know. Mm-hmm. And anybody would object to any Beethoven, he said, ta-ta-ta-ta, see? That did it.
The Mozart A major concerto, which you said figured as the first bit of Mozart, we have known through the years, through your RCA Victor recordings of it, at various stages in your career. And now, of course, in this collection of the five Mozart concerti, here you are playing it. Do you consider that this performance is perhaps a summation of your views of the piece?
Look here, there is a very disagreeable answer I have to give you, both for myself, for the Victor Company, and for all concerned. I adore every new record which I accept, you know, which I pass, because I have the right not to pass it if I don't think it good enough. But I'm so enthusiastic about the new record that I try to have always a public to listen to it, you know. It's not very easy to get them. You see, I'm offering even prizes for it, you know. I'm ready to give $5 an hour for listening
really?
To the record. Because my family's always busy and everybody, you know how they are, you know. Oh, not now, to daddy, you know, tomorrow might be, and so on. So I'm frustrated.
I'm available the next time you're in that situation,
thank
Mr.
you very
Rubinstein.
Much. I will Fine. Profit by that. See, I love it. Sometimes a visitor comes just to ask me what weather, you know, what time it is. I said, oh, don't you want to listen to a new record? You see, but all that told, after 3 or 4 or 5 months, I'm ready to make a new record because I advance, I change. There's something in me which wants something different about that same piece, and the record never changes, you see? And there is a divorce. There is not one single record which I really accept wholeheartedly after a year. Not one single. You see, those Mozarts, of course, I adore them just now. But I'm perfectly sure that in about half a year, I would like to play them again. You see, I apply that to everything in life. You see, I don't like people who stick pedantically to an opinion having been said 10 years ago. You know mm-hmm. how sometimes people try to pin you down? Even interviewers on television, I've seen one of those hard fellows, you know, who interview people with old magazines or old articles in their hands and said, weren't you saying one day that you liked Brahms better than Beethoven? And you say, oh yes, I was such a fool 10 years ago, but I changed 9 years
yes.
ago. Another opinion, you know, I mean, but they will not take that. You see, they like to pin you down, you see, and that is nonsensical. You know that I don't like to write letters. I mean, I will send a telegram or a letter about a thing like meeting you tomorrow, or I will send you this thing, or I will, you know, something absolutely normal, something simple. But expressing opinions or feelings or something like that in a letter, is for me extremely difficult, because once put the envelope into a mailbox, you know, I changed right away the whole opinion about the whole thing. I said, why did I write that? I don't feel it at all just now. You see?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because I'm thinking forward. I'm thinking ahead. I'm trying to change. I'm getting new ideas. I see there's another world around me right away, in an hour, tomorrow morning. You understand?
One must
be able to do that, not stick just for the pedantic reason. Oh, I said that, I must stick to it, you see now.
Mm-hmm.
This is my eternal opinion. This is a nonsensical thing. And musically, it is criminal.